विभ्रदग्ना आगैः श्रिया मा परिपातय सम्राजञ्च विराजञ्च विश्रीर्या च नो गृहे
May I now request the past students of Swamiji Veda Patasala to honor Swamiji. Jai Srimannarayan, His Holiness Sri Chandji Swamiji. The Swamiji who has graciously consented to come to Chennai and offer his Mangala Sasanams to all of us by his lucid explanation of Samanatvam in Telugu for the past 2 days at Kuchalambal Kalyana Mahal and in today evening also. We are all also fortunate to hear about the life and death, the role of an Acharya, Bhagavad Ramanujacharya, and his Guru Parampara in liberating us from the karmic bondage of life and death during Swamiji's Anugraha Bhashanam in the morning before Tirtha Goshti. Our hearty welcome to Sri Nepal Krishnamacharya Swamiji, to Sri Vemireddy Prabhakar Reddy, MP from Nellur, Dr. Pratap C. Reddy, Chairman of Apollo Hospitals, Sri Murli Garu of Sri Krishna Sweets, Sri Murthy Garu, President of Sri Tyaga Brahmagana Sabha. Sri Murli Garu, Sri Krishna Sweets, has been sponsoring today's prasadam. Sri Murthy Garu has given this hall free of charge for today's program, as in the past when we conduct our annual bhajan competitions here. A warm and hearty welcome to each and every one of you whom Sri Swamiji refers to as Bhagavad Bandhus, to come and spend your Sunday morning here when Sri Swamiji will deliver his speech on the importance of equality. I welcome you all once again and His Holiness Sri Chinnajiya Swamiji, and thank His Holiness to graciously accept and visit Chennai in spite of his pressing work schedules regarding the mammoth project of Statue of Equality of Bhagavad Ramanuja, commemorating his 1,000 years, that is a Sahasrabdi. Situated at Swamiji's ashram in Shamsabad, Hyderabad. Bhakti Nivedana is a spiritual magazine of Sri Swamiji. All Swamiji's activities and innumerable articles based on spiritualism in Telugu are there in the Telugu monthly magazine. It serves as an enlightenment to us. The English version of Bhakti Nivedana is an online version, and details can be had from Swamiji's website www.chinnajiyar.guru. Today's program at Kuchalambal Kalyana Mahal, 2:30 p.m. prize distribution for the winners of the 24th annual competitions. We have been conducting competitions based on our scriptures for school students for the past 24 years. More than 1,500 students participate in the sloka, drawing, oratorical, quiz, comprehension, and bhajan competitions. At 6 p.m., there is a Samuhika Sri Vishnu Sahasranama Parayanam, and from 6:30 to 8, Swamiji will dwell on the subject Samanatvam in Telugu. We welcome you all to participate in the programs today at Kuchalambal Kalyana Mahal also, and receive the Mangala Sasanams of His Holiness Sri Swamiji. I now invite Dr. Pratap C. Reddy Garu to speak a few words.
Your Holiness, Sri Dandi, శ్రీమన్ నారాయణ జిఆర్ చిన్న జిఆర్ స్వామి, ఫ్రమ్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ అస్ వి ఎక్స్ప్రెస్ అవర్ డీప్ అప్రిసియేషన్ ఆఫ్ ద సెవరల్ ఎఫర్ట్స్ దట్ యు ఆర్ డూయింగ్ అక్రాస్ ద వరల్డ్ టు ఇన్ ఎంకరేజింగ్ అండ్ గివింగ్ స్పిరిచువలిజం అండ్ హ్యాపీనెస్ టు ద పీపుల్ ఆఫ్ ద వరల్డ్. But for us particularly who are associated closely with you, to witness and to enhance ourselves, saying that the life could be different with your guidance and the spiritualism, is an immense benefit which necessarily need to change the society, and perhaps India should lead that society or the rest of the world. I have no words to describe what you are trying to create at Hyderabad. We are waiting, I understand that in October Sri Ramanuja Swami statue and the 80 odd temples around the country will be ready for the public. I am sure it will be an event for the world to come and see. You just told me that from the airport you could see that the radiance, the people when they are getting down, they see the radiance. And the instance you told about the British High Commissioner, when he went back to his office, he asked, what was that happened? And the secretary explained British, and I believe he came and visited the temple. So I think this is, as it is, I think it's giving the gradients and blessings for enormous number of people. For all indebted to you, Swamiji. Of course, personally, I am very, very happy because you have given us a glorious temple in our Chittoor University campus. It's a beautiful temple, and we thank you. We thank you. We hope you will visit us again. And personally, from all of our family, all that we can say is, we are very fortunate to continuously receive your blessings. God bless all of us. Swam Narayana.
Thank you, Doctor, for your wonderful message. I now request Srimati Nirmala Periaswamy to take over and compare and be the Master of Ceremonies for today's program. Srimati Nirmala Periaswamy will also give a brief of Swamiji's various activities. జై శ్రీమన్నారాయణ.
జై శ్రీమన్నారాయణ. ஒருபுறம் செல்வனும் தந்தையும் தாயும் உயர் குருவும் வெறிதரு பூமகள் நாதனும் மாறன் விளங்கிய சீர் நெறிதரு செந்தமிழ் ஆரணமே என்று இந்நீள் நிலத்தோர் அறிதர நின்ற ராமானுஜன் எனக்கு ஆறுமுதே. ஜெய் ஸ்ரீமன்னாராயணா. ஆழ்வார் எம்பெருமானார் ஜீயர் திருவடிகளே சரணம். For the inquisitive, he is an unparalleled spiritual leader. For the intellectuals, he is an erudite scholar and philosopher. For the suffering parts of the world, he is an ever-helping, inspiring leader. Eloquent speaker, reservoir of divine qualities, and a uniquely distinguished representative of world's most ancient but ever fresh Vedic knowledge and practices. He is Paramahamsa Parivirajakacharya Ubaya Vedanta Pravartaka Veda Visvavidyalaya Samsthapaka Shri 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 Tridandi Sriman Narayana Ramanuja Chinnajiyar Swamiji. Our humble pranams, Swamiji, our lovable pranams. It is actually a very difficult job to give within few minutes about His Holiness Chinnajiya Swamiji's spiritual and philanthropic activities, services, but we are trying to give a glimpse. From 4 in the morning, maybe later, maybe earlier, till midnight or even later, Swamiji is busy spreading the message of Vedas, Upanishads, on messages of great seers tirelessly. He never says no to people who want to see him even at midnight. For the suffering parts of the world, he is a helping hand. He cares for the unprivileged children and is supporting and educating them by establishing schools in tribal areas, GR Gurukulams, and for visually challenged children, Netra Vidyalaya. For the leaders, he is the most sought out for as an advisor of Vedic ways. Chinnajiya Swamiji's vision is to empower the impoverished communities across the world to have equal access and opportunities to quality education, health care and self-confidence, to live a life filled with dignity and pride, to promote harmony and peace, following two principles: serve all beings as service to God, worship your own, respect all. And his services, actually, Swamiji has started during 1983 at Vedic University. A few thousand students so far have passed out. And the School for the Blind and Junior College for the Blind, so far 300 students passed out and well placed. They were given in the whole country as the first time, only by GR Educational Trust, a laptop to attend exams and to study. Nobody ever has done that so far. And also, the tribal people, tribal children, they have, hundreds of children have passed out. They're all well placed, not only passed out, not only from schools, they're joining in colleges, universities, getting good ranks, going out, they are really getting good jobs in government, in private sector, in corporates, in IITs, and etc., etc. Really a very great service. And about healthcare, Jim's Hospital is run by his GR Educational Trust, and women's cancer camps. So far, Swamiji has done 9 lakh women cancer camps and other medical camps also, multi-organ donation camps, environmental. He's working in multifaceted area, what not, environmental protection, Go Green initiative, Goshala, drinking water, free food distributions, clothes donation, old age homes, orphanages, my God. And then mass prayer programs also, using old Vedic techniques in the drought stricken areas in South India. Swamiji had made rain to come. He had brought rain during those drought stricken times. And Yuva Vikas is his youth wing. And social service wing of Swamiji is Vikasa Tarangini, as you all know. My dear brethren, now Swamiji is building a statue of equality, our Swami Ramanuja statue, 216 feet, Panchaloha ideal, in commemorating 1000th year of his birth. And Swamiji will give all the details now. Equality is the main motto, main principle of Swami Ramanuja from before 1000 years, from 1000 AD, I think. Thank you so much. Swamiji will give the presentation of the Statue of Equality now.
Hajar saal.
Aapadam apahartaram दातारं सर्वसंपदां लोकाभिरामं श्रीरामं भूयो भूयो नमाम्यहम्। जय श्रीमन्नारायण। फॉर यू। Jai Sriman Narayan. Thank you. Priya Bhagat Bandhava, should we chant a small bhajan and start it? We say once and let us all join. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Sriman Narayana. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Jai Jai. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Sriman Narayana. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Jai Jai. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Sriman Narayana. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Jai Jai. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Sriman Narayana. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Jai Jai. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Sriman Narayana. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Jai Jai. Jai Sriman Narayana, Jai Jai Jai. Bol Lakshmi Narayana Bhagavan ki. Ramanuja Swami Ji Maharaj ki. Samasta Bhakta Brind ki. Jai Sriman Narayana. Priya Bhagavad Bandhava, we are so happy to be with you on this Sunday morning. Today, our JET organizers asked us to speak about equality, which is, I think, probably a very critical and very delicate issue today. Most of you must be aware of the recent issues happening from the Supreme Court, right? With regard to Ayyappa Temple, people wanted equality. It's good. But before talking about equality, we need to know what equality is all about. What kind of equality? What type of equality? Is it a functional equality? Physical equality? Cultural equality? There are many a type with regard to equality, right? I had a question just for you all. There are many limbs in your body. which part of your body is very important? Really? Our doctor garu says, mind is very important, brain is very important. Of course, it's important. There is no doubt about it. But what about heart? Our doctor garu is very famous for treating the hearts, making the hearts, and giving strength to the hearts. Is heart not important? What about kidneys then? What about a liver? What about a pancreas? My friends, we have many limbs in our body, many parts in our body. There are vital organs, there are motor organs, some are visible, and of course many are invisible in this body. Can we say that this part is more important than this? Is there anything like that in the body? You cut the hair, still it grows. You cut the nails, still they grow. They are also very important. How much money is spent on cosmetics? For some people, to create the hair which is not there. For some people, to show the hair which is in a different way. And for some people, of course, to maintain the hair. How many people are living on that? Do we consider that hair is not important? Nail you cut, again it grows. How much money is spent on nails? When we go through some places, we see there are many, 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 many shops, you know, to treat the nails, to decorate the nails, to maintain the nails. And how many industries are surviving in maintaining the hair and nails? Even our friend Mr. Kishore. My friends, there is no single part which is having lesser importance in our body. All parts are equally valued, isn't it? In our own body? Now, should we say that there is equality among all the parts of the body? Yes? So, should we treat all the parts equally then? My question to you guys is, why you are feeding only through the mouth? Why not through the nose then? Nose is also equally climbing. Why should not I feed you by body? Mouth, you are pretty partial. You only eat everything. You only drink everything. Why not me? Have you ever seen any kind of climbing the right like that? You might have seen, probably you might have forgotten. Our doctor garu, of course, see every day such people. For some people, their nose climbed that why not I too can eat? Why should only the mouth? Then doctor garu will help such people. They admit them in the hospital and they push through a few pipes through the nose also. They start feeding through the nose. Have you seen such people? Because there is a claim for equality. Nose also wanted equal right. Do you accept it? Do you permit it? Do you think that person is a healthy guy? Yes or no? I want you to understand. What a kind of equality then your body is enjoying between different organs. There is equality with regard to their activity is designated to them. There is a specific activity assigned to each of these organs. Hands are assigned with a responsibility, legs with some other responsibility, nose with some other responsibilities, also eyes, ears, mouth, every part. We want equality among all the parts of the body to work in their own area which is allocated to them. This is okay. There should be equal provision between all these organs to make their placement proper, their activity effective. Then they are enjoying equality in the body. How many of you agree with me? My friends, if this is agreeable, if this logic is fine, or probably if this practicality is true, why can't we apply this in the world also? Why can't we see this kind of activity, this kind of equality in the society as well? There are people, there are animals, there are birds, and there are many other species surviving in this world. We consider all these are different parts of a big body called world or universe. Each part is important, no doubt. But each part should play its own role and enjoy its own freedom in executing that particular activity. Then, as the body is healthy, that the society will be healthy, that the world will be healthy. Let us confine to human beings, probably, you know, just confining the periphery of this word equality. We are human beings. According to our Vedic scriptures, God created the entire universe. I think probably everybody accepts it, right? No matter whether they are Christians, whether they are Islamic people, whether they are Hindus, whether they are Zoroastrians, and whoever they may be. They say God created this universe. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna said, Chaturvarnyam maya srishtam guna karma vibhagasah. Ho Arjuna, I created this world with Chaturvarnyam, with four varnas. Most of you might have heard about it. Right? Can anyone tell me what are those Chaturvarnyam? What is that? Aha, that's great. 100 marks. To be given to you. To be given if it is right. My friend says, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaisya, Sudra. It's great. But Lord said in Bhagavad Gita, in that sloka, this entire universe is created by me in Chaturvarnyam. This is what Lord said. I don't think that Lord ever speaks lies. He always very truthful. If that is the case, then if the Chaturvarnyam is Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaisya and Sudra, who created animals? Who created birds? Who created ants, mosquitoes, bugs, lizards, trees, and many, many, many other things? You? Or anybody else? Are you a scientist in labs? No. So it is said by our great acharyas, like Ramanujacharya Swami, in his commentary to Bhagavad Gita, Chaturvarnyam doesn't mean that Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaisya and Sudra. Chaturvarnyam is the entire universe. Then how come it is included in four or divided into four? It is like this. This is what Ramanuja Swami said in Bhagavad Gita Bhashyam. The whole world is only Chaturvarnyam, categorized into four. Let us start from us. We are all falling into one category called humans. We means who? We people in India, some people in America, and some of these in Australia, or some in Europe, some is in Arab countries and other parts of the world. All the creatures walking vertical. Some people may be walking vertical, but they may be, you know, called by Telugu people as Addagadidalu. But for God's sake, let us take them also as the vertically moving creatures, right? Manavas. We call all these as just one category, one section. All human beings, irrespective of their color, race, religion, caste, creed, sect, section, you name 100 things. But we are all one as human beings. This is what Lord Krishna said in Bhagavad Gita, and Ramanuja Swami gave this description in his Gita Bhashyam, the fourth chapter this sloka is from. So we are called Manavas. And then there are some other category of living organisms on this planet Earth which move horizontal, like all kinds of animals. They move horizontal, right? We move vertical, they move horizontal. And then there are some other creatures like flies and mosquitoes and, you know, other small creatures, insects. They also move horizontal. And fish and other things in the water, under the waters, they also move horizontal. Birds, they also move horizontal. So all the moving organisms other than the humans are considered as horizontally moving organisms. In Sanskrit, they call them as Tiryak Jati. We all Manava Jati. And others are called Tiryak Jati. There are other organisms on this earth which never move on their own. Few are with life and few without life. Which are with life are trees, plants, bushes, shrubs. All these are having life in them. But they don't move on their own. If you move them, that's fine. But they never move on their own. If wind blows, then that's a different issue. But they never move on their own. And other things without life, like stones, mountains, water, they never move on their own. They are called sthavaras. So sthavara is one section, one jati, or one varnam. That is called sthavara. Either stones without life, or trees and plants, greenery with life, they are called sthavaras. And other thing that moves horizontal is called tiryak jati. And we is a special jati, manavas. This is third category. And there is another category which is supporting our life. Invisibly something and visibly something. Fire, it's visible, supports our life. Wind, invisible but supports our life. Cold, invisible but supports our life. Heat supports our life. And there are innumerable forces in the nature which are supporting us, which are called invisible but always delightful. So they are called Deva Jati. Most of the times, you know, we people think that Deva means somebody with wonderful kiritams and having the pattu dhotis and having gold, you know, jewelry all through their body, and they are flying across the skies. This is what we understand because we are very much acquainted with the movies. You know, they show in the movies like that, right? Deva Jati goes across the clouds and skies. So they think, oh, Devatas means like that. No. Div Kridayam is a beautiful root in Sanskrit. They do activities so casually, but more perfectly, to support all the life on this planet. And of course, elsewhere, maybe. They are called Deva Jati. How many they are like that? Maybe 3.30 millions. Muppattu Mover Amarar. This is what Andal said in her beautiful Tirupavai. They are 33 crores, it seems. We did not count. Whatever they said, that what we follow, we understand. But anyway, they are called Deva Jati. So there is one jati which is invisible but supporting the life on this earth, which are called Deva. We all, maybe blacks, maybe whites, maybe browns, or maybe something else. Let them identify themselves with caste. Let them identify with religion. Let them identify with money, with education, whatever it is. But they are all humans. Deva, Manushya, Tiryak, and Sthavara. Four jatis. Not Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaisya, and Sudra. Can you identify any object which is not falling in these four categories? Any object across the universe, anywhere? Nothing. Anything you show will definitely fall among these four. That's it. This is what Lord Krishna said. Chaturvarnyam maya srishtam guna karma vibhagasya. I created this entire universe with these four. So, let us come to an understanding, leaving other objects aside, confined to ourselves. Let us take the human beings first of all. We all falling into one category. And because we are all falling in one category, and we have probably equal rights, understand? Equal rights. If you take all the humanity as a unit, as a body, and people like us, some are white, tall, stout, heavy, and some lean, short, and, you know, slim. There are many categories, right? Even among ourselves, speaking different languages, doing different activities. But we are all falling into one category, my friends. But my question now is, we are having equality. Equality for what? Equality how? What a kind of equality we have to enjoy now in this world? This is where 1,000 years before, a great guru born in 1017 did a great exercise, read all the scriptures, understood the essence of them, mastered the quintessence of all those scriptures, convinced his own gurus that what he say is the essence. Then only, you know, whatever we can say becomes authority. Just something crossed through my mind when I speak this. There was a great acharya called Kumarila Bhattu. Probably a few of you might have heard the name. Very great Mimamsaka. Mimamsaka means studied Vedas and studied the practical part of the Vedas and performed that with authenticity and with accuracy. Kumarila Bhattu was the scholar, authoritarian with regard to Mimamsa in those days, during the period of Shankaracharya Swami. When Shankaracharya Swami was a young scholar, Kumarila Bhattu was already grown up and aged scholar. Very powerful Mimamsaka of those days. But Shankaracharya wanted to condemn those practices. And he wants to establish the philosophy is more important. And he was going around the world and arguing with the people and convincing them and also bringing them to the philosophical school. During that course, Shankaracharya Swami understood something about Kumarila Bhattu and went to argue with him. But the moment he reached the place where Kumarila Bhattu used to live, he was already arranged a big husk, and he sat in the middle of that husk, and it was burning. So he was committing self-immolation. Shankaracharya was surprised. Are you, what is this? Why you are doing this? You being a great Vedic scholar, why you are like this? Why you are committing this self-immolation? Is it really good? I came to argue with you, but what can I argue with you now when you are in this stage? Sir, what happened to you to commit this kind of thing? He questioned. Then Kumarila Bhattu explained about himself. It seems Kumarila Bhattu was a very, very erudite Vedic scholar of those days when he was young. In those days, Buddhism was widespread philosophy, as it is today. And many people they were following that. Real Bodhism I am talking about. Not what we see today, but the real Bodhism. It was widespread philosophy of those days, and they never believed in idol worship. I think, probably you know very well nowadays, everywhere, if they talk about the tourism, they keep a Buddha statue. Right? The Bodhism itself, they condemned the idol worship totally. And they condemned the Vedic philosophy totally. That is Bodhism. And the followers today keep a Buddha statue and started worshipping that. You know, it is something. So, because Buddhism was widespread in those days, condemning the Vedic philosophy in general, and also they are condemning the idol worship, Shankaracharya Swami, Kumarila Bhattu thought that I should do something for this. But how can he say? If he goes to a Buddhist scholar, a Buddhist monk, a Buddhist lama, and then starts arguing, with what he has to argue? He should show the Vedic authority and then should argue with him, right? But that person, assumoto, he never accepts the Veda at all. And when you don't accept something, how can I show that as authority and argue with you? Shankaracharya Swami thought, I should not argue with these people, keeping Veda in my hand. Then what I should do? I should go to their path and should argue with them. Whatever philosophy they learned, with that philosophy, logic, I should condemn them. Then he gave up his sikha, because Vedic people usually keep sikha. They keep Ajñopavitam. They keep Kati Sutram. So he said, first of all, I should join their school. I should learn their philosophy. I should master that philosophy. Then I should condemn them. He achieved that. He gave up his sikha. He gave up his Ajñopavitam. He gave up his Kati Sutram. And he joined the monastery. And he started learning Buddhist philosophy. And then he was accepted by the so-called learned scholars of that day as whatever this Kumarila Bhattu says is the word, is the say. We can accept whatever he says. He became such an authoritarian with regard to the Bodhism. All the scholars of the day accepted Kumarila Bhattu as the scholar to talk anything about Buddhism. After that, he came out. And then he condemned all the Buddhist philosophy, totally. Now, they cannot say no. Because he was already accepted scholar of that particular philosophy. So whatever now he says, should be accepted. Because he was an accepted scholar and then started condemning that, people have nothing to deny that. They have followed. Kumarila Bhattu established the Vedic philosophy like that in those days. That's how he became a great Mimamsaka scholar. But you know what happened? Veda says, or Dharma Shastra says, Gurum Tvam Kritya Hum Kritya. Whoever disciple argues with his guru, condemns his guru, Smasyane Jayate Vrikshaha Kanka Gurudhropa Sevitaha. He takes birth as a plant in a graveyard where the eagles and other birds, after eating the corpses will land. This person will be taking birth like that. If he condemns his guru, if he argues with his guru, this is what Dharmashastra said. He was a staunch believer in Dharmashastra. Though he learnt Buddhism and condemned for the sake of, you know, good, establishing the Vedic philosophy, but anyway he argued with his guru, right? He learnt it from gurus and then he condemned his guru. That means his fate also will be like a tree in a graveyard. And what is the prayaschittam for that? There is a prayaschittam recommended in Vedas, is to commit self-immolation. Because I believed in scriptures, I follow the scriptures, and to establish their authenticity, I did that. But still I condemned my gurus, right? From whomever I learned that Buddhist philosophy. So as a prayaschitta now, I am doing this self-immolation. This is what he showed to Shankaracharya Swami. But Shankaracharya Swami was awestruck. My God, how great are you? How authoritarian are you? He was very much surprised to see that. If you want to condemn anything, there are people nowadays talking about our scriptures and condemning a few things. We have no objection if somebody condemns, right? When they also read them, they also understand them, then condemn, fine. Here is a great doctor who studied medicine, who practiced medicine, who preached medicine, who spread the medicine across the world. If I want to condemn the medicine, you know, I just simply cannot go and say, hey doctor, I don't accept you. Nobody agrees. If you are really interested in doing so, you also study the medicine to the extent that what the doctor studied, understand the philosophy, what they understood, and grow to that level. And if you find really that is something to be condemned, then you can put your argument forth. Otherwise, you just cannot. Somebody wants to condemn the presence of God and other philosophical ideologies, they can definitely do it. When? If they study in total, if they acquire mastery over that, and if they are accepted by the then scholars of the day, and then they can definitely do that. Ramanujacharya Swami, during his time, studied with the scholars of the day. And he acquired mastery over the subject. And then he proved that his knowledge is flawless. When Guruji has given the definition to a few mantras, and Ramanujaswami corrected them, rectified the deficiencies in giving the meanings, and presented a perfectly understandable, contextual meaning, and then made them accept what Ramanuja said is right. After doing so, then Ramanuja spoke about the inequalities that were prevailing in the society of the day. It was then Ramanujacharya Swami spoke about the taboos that were prevailing in the society. And then he condemned them. There was a lot of inequality in those days, yes. Today people are talking about equal rights, you know, with regard to the Ayyappa temple. But it is so sad, they don't know what does equality mean. They don't know what our great people did in olden days or till today. In those days, all were not permitted into temples. All were not permitted to chant the mantras also. And here now there are many women. All of, probably many of you must be chanting some mantras. Am I right or wrong? I think women has to say the ladies. Are you chanting some mantras? A few mantras at least, not necessarily all the mantras, but a few mantras. All of you are chanting, right? Can I take it for granted? Thank you. And those who are here as a caste other than the Brahmins, you are also chanting a few mantras. Am I right or wrong? That's a great thing. This was not the order of that day. If anybody other than the Brahmins chant mantra, cut their tongue. Listen to the mantra, fill their ears with melted lead. Was the order of the day. It appears pretty crude, right? Very cruel. Very barbaric. It is true. It was like that. But Ramanuja Swami gone through the scriptures. Is it what Veda said? Is it what our rishis said? Is this what our Purva Acharyas practiced? But he found, no, that was not. Because in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna said that he gave mantra to everybody. Amidst 18 Akshauhinis, he revealed the Bhagavad Gita. Right? In Bhagavad Gita, I think he accepted everyone. Yo me bhaktya prayachati. Yo. Whoever may be. He did not specifically say only these people to offer something to me. He said anyone. He gave a blank check. When you chant Vishnu Sahasranama, I think most of you must be knowing that, right? In that Bhishmacharya gave all the very, very powerful mantras that were preached to him by the great sage Vedavyasa. And Vedavyasa collected them all from the very, very highly orderly people like rishis. Very, very precious mantras. And made a few powerful garland, which is called Vishnu Sahasranama, which he gave to the Yudhishthira, the eldest of Pandavas. He said, I am going to tell all these mantras to you, Yudhishthira, not only to you, Tani Vakshyami Bhutaye. Tani Vakshyami Bhutaye. Yani Namani Gaunani Vikhyatani Mahatmanaha. Rishibhi Parigitani. Tani Vakshyami Bhutaye. Whoever thinks that he is an existent. He is an existent. He did not say a specific caste, a specific color, a specific sex, specific race or religion. He said it is to everybody. If you think that you are an existent, do it. Go ahead with it. That's what they said. And most of the scriptures also speaking the same truth, speaking the same tone. When that is the case, why we have to be like this? This was what Ramanuja Swamiji thought. And then, for him itself, it took 18 times to go to Tirukostur from Srirangam, all the way on foot, 18 times. Go, come, go, come, go, come, not now, come then, not now, come then. But with all patience, he walked 18 times to Goshtipuram, Tirukottiyur from Srirangam. And of course, on 18th time, Guruji was very much convinced and revealed the mantra to him. But after getting the mantra, he just opened it to the entire universe. Not only just opening the mantra to the universe, but also he made a lineage of gurus. He established the lineage of acharyas, giving them the instructions to go round the world and preach it to people whoever are interested. Parulahil, Asayudayor Kellam Aryarhal, Kurum Enru Pesi, Varambu Arutarpin. He broke those taboos and opened the mantra to everybody. And temples were opened to the so-called untouchables also. The so-called untouchables. Lord Ranganatha accepted the untouchable and made him a great saintly person, and his name became Tiruppanan. Tiruppani Alvar Ancholuvar Avarai. Right? So this is what they said. This is what God did. Tomorrow is a beautiful Ekadasi, a very, very divine Ekadasi. Do you know? How many of you? If I say tomorrow is Ekadasi, from today we become so weak. Ekadasi, tomorrow? We eat today, but still we become weak. The Ekadasi is such a powerful one, you know. But tomorrow is a unique Ekadasi. To talk about equality, this Ekadasi is dedicated by Puranas, not by us, by Puranas. And tomorrow's Ekadasi is named after an untouchable person, Kaisika Ekadasi. You know, Kaisika Ekadasi. The wonderful story is behind. The one for whom we are performing this Ekadasi was an untouchable guy, living in a small village and very fond of the deity in Tirukkurungudi, which is near Vanamamalai, near Totadri, probably near Kanyakumari. And he, every Ekadasi he used to go there and sing the glories of the Lord, not entering the temple. He was only just going around the streets and singing the glories of God and used to come back. But on this Ekadasi, that is tomorrow, he wanted to sing the glories of the Lord and left his home for the temple. But in the way, there is a big forest, a dense forest. As he was crossing through the forest, he took rest in the evening under a big banyan tree on which there is a ghost. And that ghost found this person. Was very handsome person. And the ghost thought, I got a wonderful, delicious and fresh food today for me. And the ghost wanted to eat that person. And then the untouchable guy said, I pray to you. You want to eat me, right? Give me a little chance. Tomorrow morning is the Ekadasi. I go to Tirukkurungudi, sing the glories of the Lord and come back, and of course I become pray for you. No problem. But let me finish this little service to the Lord as my final wish. And then the ghost said, it's very wonderful. You know, somebody kept his head into the tiger's face and says, hey tiger, please give me some time. I come back and become food for you. Do you think it is believable? I want to let you go. Then he took many pledges. And being happy with those pledges, the ghost said, okay, go. Finish your service and come back. Be careful. And he said, believe in me. I stand for my word. And he went, sung the glories of the Lord, returned to the same place and sat down, you know, the tree, under the tree. And the ghost was very much surprised. Are you appear to be pretty innocent or fool. You came back. I thought it is gone forever. And again you came. I feel sorry for you. But anyway, I think that you are a pretty genuine guy. I let you go if you do some favor to me. Tell me, what favor can I do? You sung the glories of the Lord, right? So give that entire punyam to me so that, you know, I let you go. And then this guy said, I'm so sorry. I just can't do such a kind of thing, please. Then he started bargaining with that person. At least You did your singing prayers on all the four sides of the temple, right? So you give me at least three sides punyam. I'm sorry. Two sides. I'm really, really sorry. He started, you know, making the deal. But finally, this untouchable said, look, I never did something for the sake of punyam. Whatever little I did as a service to the Lord. When I just offered things as a service to the Lord, do you think that punyam comes to me? And even it comes, it is not for me. Because it is He who made me do. So it is for Him, entire thing belongs. So nothing is for me. Neither punyam is there with me, and that's all. So how can I give which is not with me? I'm not a politician to make promises. So I just can't do that. But it was so surprising. Because that ghost spoke with a great devotee for such a long time, it seems it was released from the curse that it was going through. And then it said, hey, look, I was a great Vedic scholar in my previous birth. But I broke the yajnam in the middle. So I became a devil like this. But speaking with you, a very, very great devotee, made me released from this sin. And so now I am freed. You are blessed. I am blessed by you. You are blessed by the God. That person, though untouchable, was able to relieve from the pains and sins a great Vedic scholar who became a devil. Untouchable guy. But that Ekadasi was designated on his name, and the song that he sung on the day in the Kaisika Raga. So the Ekadasi's name became Kaisika Ekadasi. That person's name we don't know. He was considered as a Mala Dasari. So now Mala is a caste probably which is untouchables used to be called in those days. And he was a singer, that's all. Just like Tirupanan. Though he was an untouchable by virtue of his birth, but by virtue of his adoption, by virtue of his devotion, he was considered so great. And today's Ekadasi, the tomorrow, actually the Ekadasi started now already. Right? After 10:30, the Ekadasi already entered. So it is till tomorrow. So tomorrow is the observing Ekadasi. But anyway, this Ekadasi's name became Kaisika Ekadasi, and in Srirangam, Ramanujacharya Swami made a practice that there is a Bhattar Swami or his family today sings that Purana part about this Kaisika Ekadasi, the 100 chapters, and for each of the chapters they offer one shawl. Ranganatha seems offers the shawls to him, and after finishing the whole the Puranic part, Lord agreed or blesses that Bhattar to go on his palanquin carried by those people who carry that palanquin from the temple to his home, which is called Brahma Ratha Maryade. Brahma Ratha Maryade. We need to understand that God never showed partiality between people with regard to their caste, creed, race, or anything, or even sex. God accepted Andal, right? And God accepted a Muslim girl called Bibi Nachiyar. Bibi Nachiyar, we call her with all affection and devotion, And he accepted even such people, and then why we? This was the inspiration for Ramanujacharya Swami to break those taboos of that day and made those people enter the temple and get the grace of Lord. There is one more interesting point, that in those days all the temple services were under priestly people. But Ramanujacharya in those days divided those services 50-50. 50% in those days. He divided 50-50, and 50% services were kept with priestly people, and 50% of the services were assigned to people who are till then away from the temple, so that they also can join these people and be a part of Lord's services and feel the affinity. This is what we call equality. Equality with regard to eating food, learning things, enjoying the freedom to movement, enjoying the freedom for work, and enjoying to live well. But my friends, Ramanujacharya Swami understood the value of equality very well, as nose does its work only, mouth does its work only. It never peeps into its activity. Nose never peeps into mouth's activity. It's not supposed to be like that, right? But both have equal right to live well, to do their functions properly, not counteracting with each other, not fighting with each other. This is a kind of equality, what Ramanuja said. Unfortunate today, you know, some women probably fought for their rights to enter the Ayyappa temple and do something like that. I think, is that what you call equality? This is like nose fighting for eating food. Suppose, if some women fight, like, why should we only deliver the babies? Why can't these men deliver babies? This is an unjustifiable act. Maybe Supreme Court gives a judgment. From today on, it's only men permitted to deliver the babies, not the women. I don't know. So my friends, whatever the extent that we can go, Ramanujacharya Swami in those days, 1,000 years before, went to that extent and made the rules and regulations. No one even today can touch those things. Of course, you may ask, Swamiji, you gave the example of Ayyappa temple and talking about Ramanujacharya Swami. My point is, everyday Vaishnavites, not only in their temples, but also in their homes, say a beautiful word, at least once. Some people may do twice, some may be chanting thrice, like Ramanujarya Divyajna Vardhatam Abhivardhatam. Why? Sahi Loka Hitaishini. What does it mean? That is always good for the well-being of the world. Swamiji, Ramanujacharya is a Vaishnava Acharya. And how come that whatever he says he followed, that is well-being of the world? What about Saivites? What about Shaktayas? What about Ganapatyas? What about other devotees? Do you want to convert all of them to Vaishnavites? Do you want them to give up their pujas and become Vaishnavites? Then only Ramanujacharya Divyajna becomes in a Loka Hitaishini? Wrong. That's where probably nowadays narrow-minded people take a wrong turn. Though Ramanuja was a Vaishnava Acharya, but whatever he did, it is for the world. Today, we have taken a slogan. I don't know how many of you know that. Worship your own. Respect all. Worship your own. Respect all. You may be a strong devotee, and the other person may be a very strong atheist. That's okay. He believed that, you believed this. Right? This is for your survival. You chose this path, and it is that faith, probably that person chose for his survival. It's a good thing. But you should not condemn that atheist. You should not condemn his atheism, because it is what a faith he got in. At the same time, that person also should accept your way also is your faith. He should not condemn you. He need not follow you, but he should respect you. He can follow his own thing. So he can worship his way and he can respect your way. Vice versa. You can worship your way, but you need to respect the way of the other guy. Will it be a good thing? Is it a right thing to do? So, maybe you are a Hindu, maybe you are a Christian, maybe you are a Muslim, maybe you are an atheist or something, blah, 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 whatever it is. Whatever you believe in, worship that. Whatever you did not believe, respect it. Respect it. As long as it's not causing any harm to the society. But when it is harmful to the society, definitely it will be condemned by the government itself, by the court itself. We need not do that. There are people to do that. This is our policy. This is what Ramanuja did in those days. He made rules and regulations to the temples. He made rules and regulations to the society. Like, if you are a believer in a deity, this should be the temple way. This should be the priestly way. This should be the devotee's way. This should be the other people like cooks and other service holders' way. Be that way. If you are a strong Vaishnavite, to do the pujas in Vaishnava temple, you should take a Panchasamskaram, right? And most of you know that. It is called Panchasamskaram, Vaishnava Diksha. Take the Diksha and be a part of the temple. Maybe you are a peon, maybe you are a chairman. In between everyone, if you are not a Dikshita of that particular faith, don't touch that at all. Vice versa. If you are a Saivet, and when you believe in Lord Shiva, there is another Diksha also to become a part of Shiva temple. Maybe you are a peon, maybe you are a priest, maybe you are an organizer, or a trustee, or a chairman, no matter, or a devotee. Take the Diksha and go there. Otherwise, don't entertain that at all. And if you are a Shaktaya, even for becoming a Shaktaya, there is a process. Take the Diksha, be in that way, and live like that. This is what Ramanuja did in those days, my friends. He not just confined to his Vaishnavism alone, but he confined to the scriptures. Scriptures talk about Vishnu. Scriptures talk about Shiva. Scriptures talk about Shakti. Scriptures talk about other devatas called Ganapatyam. So whichever way you believe in, this should be the norm. These are the protocols, and everybody should follow that. This is the instruction he gave to the rulers of the day. That's why the rulers, the scholars of all sects of the day said, Sarva Desha Dasha Kaleshu. That means in all places, in all states. State means status. And then in all times, Sarva Desha Dasha Kaleshu Avyahata Parakrama Ramanujarya Divyajna Vardhatam Abhivardhatam. Let the command of Ramanuja spread all over the world. Why? Sahi Loka Hitaishini. Because that is for the well-being of the world, for the well-being of the people, for the well-being of the communities, to respect each other. But ultimately, you know, I being a devotee, follow my way. And my friend being an atheist, follows his way. We both live together. Respecting each other, we live together. And thus, we both serve the society. We both serve the nation. And we make a landmark. We make, where we set ourselves an example. This is what Ramanuja said in those days. So, my friends, he never said that you have to convert that into this. You know, go to a Shiva temple, convert it as a Vaishnava temple. Go to Vaishnava temple and convert it as a Shiva temple. Or go to a mosque and convert it as a temple. Or go to the temple, convert it as a mosque or a church. No. This is not what Ramanuja, this is not the lineage of Ramanuja did ever in this country or elsewhere. So, if you are a really believer of your own body, understanding that equality here, every part is equally having the right to play a role in your life, isn't it? And you are allowing that. You are giving ultimate freedom to that part. Otherwise, doctors are always there to help you in bestowing the freedom to those parts so that they can function properly and well. Freedom is there. Equality is there. Freedom for action. And equality for living with cohesiveness, not quarreling with others. This is also there. And then living on its own. Whatever the food that mouth takes, supplies to the hand, supplies to the heart, supplies to the brain, supplies to the kidneys and lungs and pancreas and so on. So, every part. There is no partiality. You know, some type of blood is needed to the brain, some type of blood is needed to the heart, some type of blood is needed to the regular other muscles. Heart is taking that responsibility and doing that sincerely. What, Dr. Garu? So, you have to allow those parts to function freely without any pressure on them. To render their duties properly. Unfortunately, today, even the Supreme Court judges also have no freedom. What to say? What would be the fate of the country? That poor guy, able to bear with the pressure till the last day, and then signed and left the court. It seems, I don't know. It seems. Is this the way the world should, you know, enjoy the freedom or enjoy the equality? That is what Ramanuja did in those days, that how the equality must be given, what type of equality and how. My friends, it is only just a brief introduction. We are not able to, or probably we don't know about it, and so we can't understand. But try to read the story of such great acharyas, you can understand. I'll show you one statement of Mr. Modi, how he spoke about the Ramanuja 1,000 years before, in doing the reforms and in implementing the value of the equality. Look over there. It was a statement he gave. during the stamp release on May 1st last year. Please.
हजार साल पहले इस प्रकार का
He says, even we cannot touch few things. Being the ruler of the country, I just can't touch a few issues. More than that was done by Ramanujacharya in those days, 1,000 years before. My friends, you may be a Chief Justice of Supreme Court, but after all, you are a man. Right? Well, they are all human beings. They have their own, probably, ways of thinking. They have their own limitations. But our scriptures spoke about equality. Our acharyas made those things pretty strong and really practical. No political motivation. No selfish ends. Just what the Modi said, Jan Kalyan, Jagat Kalyan ke liye karte the. Their ulterior motive is to see that the well-being of the world, well-being of the people, and whatever we do should aim at that. But if this motive is there, I think things will be always good. But if that's not there, then that is where the society will be in trauma. So today, we are bringing out this project of Ramanujacharya Swami in Semshabad, in an area of almost 70 acres. As the hub of Ramanuja Swami's philosophy and practices. And we want it to be a destination point for understanding the real values of equality. If we understand the equality, then I think other things become meaningful. Otherwise, you know, two people may be living together, but they don't understand each other. They keep fighting every day, you know. Then there won't be any kind of peace at all. That is what's happening today. See the world scenario, how the Syria is, how the other parts are. But that is not what we want. We want a livable place. We want an enjoyable life. We want a cohesive living on this planet Earth as long as we are here. And Ramanujacharya Swami showed the path for the world. That is where probably we are trying to work out. And we are trying to involve a little technology there so that we can understand the life mission of Ramanujacharya Swami. How he did a kind of coordination between rulers and bureaucrats, elite of the society, and common man. These are the four corners, never come together. Whatever the rulers want, bureaucrats never accept. Whatever bureaucrats do, that's not for good of the society. Whatever the elite think, maybe sometimes not in the reach of common man. But common men always need a lot. It is Ramanujacharya Swami, 1,000 years before, bridged the gap between all these four corners and made a very perfect society and established a wonderful lineage. I spoke about this with Mr. Modi in 2017, during July. And then he got a question. He asked us a question. Swamiji, you said Ramanuja Swami did it in 1,000 years before. Why we are still today like this? Why there is untouchability existing today? This is what he questioned. I said, it's a genuine question. And there is there's something that happened that I have to tell you. I said, what Ramanuja did then in 11th century was in practice till 17th century. Till the East India Company came to India, it was well in practice. You take the history of the country. You go to the northeastern countries, you go to western parts of the India, or you see the southern part, everywhere, whatever Ramanuja did was well in practice. But when East India Company came to this place, they know how to split the people and how to bake their bread. And then they played a card where they wanted to divide people with the name of caste, creed, etc., breaking the culture. There is a letter written by Lord Macaulay in 1832 to the British Queen. I think most of you must be knowing, right? Right. There are a few hands I am able to see here. Yes. He wrote a letter to the British Parliament saying, I went round the country, east, west, north and south. I visited all the nook and corners. I did not find a single beggar anywhere in this world, this country. No single beggar. And the cultural bondage among the masses is so strong, we cannot rule this country. Until we break them with a kind of education where they think that everything that indigenous is bad. Anything comes from foreign is good. Till we are able to achieve that, we just can't rule this country. You can go to the Google, you can search for the letter of Lord Macaulay written to the British Parliament, and you can read all these words. He was appointed as a commission for that, forming the education system. He took 10 years to create the history of the country. And during 1842, he presented the system of education, how it should be to the Indian people. And then, since then, till today, we are very, very sincere, religiously following what that gentleman presented to us. No matter it is Vaidehi Amma's college, a school, or any school in that sense. No one is able to touch that education system where you think that you have nothing with you, everything was given by foreigners, that's how you are making your life today. All the sciences, all the knowledge, everything that you have today is their contribution. Because you thought that this is the letter. You can, of course, read it later. Because of that, we lost it. And we asked Mr. Modi, the country chose you, my friend. In spite of 70 years of independence, no ruler bothered about it, except a few like Lal Bahadur Shastri. And something about the Mr. PV. And nobody bothered about the country. Nobody wanted this country to flourish. Everybody wanted to just eat like insatiable rats. Fortunate enough, the country chose you. Do at least in your time. Do something during your tenure. That's what we said. And the result of that is, in 2017, August 15th, while he was speaking from the Red Fort, probably the first Prime Minister of India ever spoke about the gurus of this country. Did you hear the speech of Modi on Independence Day during 2017? He started taking the name of Ramanuja Swami. Not once. He took the name for 5 times. It is very interesting. And then we requested him to release the stamp of Ramanuja. He did it, of course, during 2018, May 1st, what you just heard before, during which he spoke. He gathered, of course, all the information. And we gave just a small lead point to him that Ambedkar also spoke about Ramanuja. But then he brought out the entire information that Ambedkar during June 3rd, he wrote an editorial about Ramanuja Acharya in his magazine. Ambedkar was having a magazine, it seems. And in his magazine, he wrote an editorial about Ramanuja Acharya, adoring him like anything. So, Mr. Modi said Ambedkar was a great fan of Ramanuja Acharya. Ambedkar praised only Ramanuja Acharya, the guru, when he was taking the gurus of this nation. This is what Modi said, not me. Of course, you can search for that in Google. Narendra Modi about Ramanuja Acharya. If you click, you get all the information. So, my friends, equality is something Ramanuja knows very well. Because of his scholarship, he was able to convince all sections of the society and made it in a practice for almost 700 years. Though it was damaged, but still it is in practice till today in many a part. But it is the best time for all of us because his millennium year is this. His millennium year. Though it is 2017, but you know, the first 10 years we can take it for granted for 1,000 years, right? We can celebrate that all through. For such a great guru, what best we can contribute to him? If you get an apple, you say thanks. Right? When he gave such a kind of value to the entire, not just nation, for the humankind in general, what token of gratitude that we can show. Not only me, not only Vaishnavites, but the humankind in general should be grateful to such a great Acharya who spoke about the equality, who practiced equality, and who made even the centers of the temples also to observe the value of the equality, to practice that equality. What a kind of gratitude we can show. We thought probably this project is a flower of gratitude to his lotus feet. That's why we wanted all of you also take the pride of being a part of that. We don't consider Ramanuja Acharya as just a spiritual leader, just as a religious Acharya. No. We think that Ramanuja Acharya is far, 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 far ahead of the modern scholars, the modern politicians, the modern bureaucrats, and the modern thinkers. And he made that established through his philosophy. That's why, in addition to the Ramanuja statue there, which is already finished, of course, during last year itself, but we thought to bring around Ramanuja Acharya something that's really needed. There are 108 temples, which we call as Divya Desas. I gave you one example, the Tirukkurungudi. Tirukkurungudi is talking about an untouchable singer, right, of the day. Srirangam, I gave another example. Ranganatha accepted another untouchable guy as his lotus feet and we are singing the glories of him as an altar, even today. So every temple out of 108 stands as an example to follow the equality. Ramanuja was tremendously inspired by those. That's why we thought, if we bring all those 108 around Ramanuja Swami, when those temples are able to bring out one Ramanuja for that day, and if those temples are really experienced by us, I think those who visit that place, every one of us may become like Ramanujacharya, right? Or at least, you know, 1%. If not 100%, of course that's ruled out because of our brain today. But at least 0.00000001%. Still it is great. If you are able to raise even to that level, taking the inspiration of those 108 places, it is right. It's great. World will be benefited. Forget about our own benefit. The world will be benefited in general. That is the aim of creating this project. And that's the aim of creating the temples around. Of course, it is a 1,000 crores project. So far, 600 crores were spent in that project. Doesn't matter. When we conceived this project, there are many people who laughed at us. Swami, then it was only 80 crores project. When we initially conceived this, it was just 80 crores. But we wanted it to be a lively one, where people get inspiration from that. With regard to the social needs, the world needs something now. We want to create that are related and historic ones from the Ramanuja's life all around that, for which the project started growing from 80 to 120, 120 to 200, 200 to 400, 4 to 600, now it is 1,000. But already 600 crores were spent. Where from? No pockets to me. No printing press in our office. And no bundles stored somewhere under the beds. It is you people who made it to happen. It is how people got inspired. It is how they started coming forward from US, from Australia, from other parts of the world. Those who thought that they have a responsibility to understand the value of the real value of the equality and the great contribution of Ramanujacharya and our duty to him, they all responded positively, and that's how the support started coming. And so far 600 crores were spent. Even I didn't do that. I didn't believe in me, but I believe in the grace of Acharya. I strongly believe in his power of his grace, which can make anything to happen. All that our ego should not creep into that. If you are egotistic, then you lost everything. We are trying to. We are trying to be away from the ego, and we are trying to see that his grace should work always. And we are sure the project will be finished. And as Dr. P.C. Reddy said, yes, during the next year, it will be dedicated to the world of good-hearted people. It will be dedicated to the world of visionaries. It's dedicated to the world of, you know, people who have gratitude towards our ancestors and predecessors who showed us the path, brought us to this level. My friends, we love to invite you all to be a part of this kind of cause in whatever way it's possible, and get the benefit of it. And let us be grateful always to our acharyas. And I'm very happy for your patience and allowing me to speak for this long. And I offer Mangala Sasanams to our JET and Vikas Tarangini organization volunteers who made this afternoon really useful and enjoyable by us. Jai Sriman Narayana.
An unselfish nature of his guru, Swami Ramanuja, who taught the Thiruvandaram against his guru's will, knowing very well about his punishment. We, the devotees, believe our Chinnajayar Swamiji is the reincarnation of Manavala Mamunigal, who himself was the reincarnation of Swami Ramanuja. The Guru Parampara continues their tireless services too. Thank you once again, Swamiji. We would like to request you all at least once try to visit Shamsabad. Vani Mahal President Sri Murthy Avargal. Garlanded by Sri Swamiji now. Mr. and Mrs. Venugopal of Naidu Hall expressed his concern about a thing. He said, our people are all very religious, very devoted, going to temple, visiting temples. He would like all of us to serve others, to take part in service.